The book is in some ways a kind of unexpected or unusual early history, a kind of prehistory of places like the IQC, or of this intense worldwide interest in quantum information science. And so what I was curious about is where do those types of places come from, intellectually, to some degree institutionally, because the topics that are studied with such great care and attention today were really marginalized for a long time, not that long ago, a couple decades. Thinking about and playing with for a long time on physics in the Cold War and looking at sort of a series of boom and bust cycles, amazing growth in the field, numbers of students growing exponentially, research funding growing exponentially, coming out of World War II and again after Sputnik, the kind of Cold War imperatives to make lots and lots more physicists and engineers. And then that bubble burst very dramatically in the late 60s, early 70s. In 1971, there were over 1,000 young physicists looking for jobs and only 53 jobs on offer. And so these assumptions, these sort of taken for granted notions of making a life in physics were up for very quick reassessment. Sort of through no fault of their own, their mistake was graduating at the wrong time. They were from the right schools, they published well, and they were just caught in this kind of whiplash of a reversal of supply and demand. And so many of them really had no jobs lined up or the barest kind of underemployed, and some of them were unemployed. Some were on welfare, at least for brief periods. They made their way to the Bay Area. They found each other through kind of clearly recognized shared interests. And they basically said, more or less, what do we have to lose, right? They had been drawn to physics by these, you know, large metaphysical questions, what does it all mean? And they were no longer going to make a path the way once might have been expected. And that meant going to unusual places. So the single longest running seminar series in the history of the Esalen Institute, which is not otherwise popularly known for science. The longest running series was on Bell's theorem and the nature of quantum theory, which is sort of mind-boggling. The director of Esalen, a co-director, was deeply impressed by the work and was very interested, still is very interested, in questions of physics and consciousness. He helped carve out a home for these folks so they could have something like a kind of parallel universe. They could have something like academic conferences. It just happened to be in Esalen with these famous hot spring baths and different kind of feel than the average academic conference. It's less surprising if you go back and realize where these people were situated. What else was going on, for example, in the San Francisco Bay Area in the early and mid-70s, in this kind of efflorescence of what would become known as the New Age, that was kind of the hot spot for the continent. Really, the Bay Area had been, you know, the kind of deepest concentration of enthusiasms for things like mind reading and visions of the future and all these kinds of things that some advocates call parapsychology and other detractors call simply just occult stuff. Try as we might, we can't sort of cleave this group off. They weren't doing something called not physics, and they were doing physics in kind of curious, idiosyncratic ways that nonetheless were always kind of tethered, sometimes very tightly, sometimes kind of loosely, to kind of illustrious, to Nobel Prize-worthy physics and physicists. And watching that kind of tracking back and forth between our what might have been, say, my own assumptions, or I think many of my colleagues' assumptions, oh, that's just real good physics, I know it when I see it, and that clearly is something else, and just kind of having to constantly blur that boundary was, I actually found it very useful. Really interesting science can be done in all kinds of ways. The folks I write about really were the kind of world-leading early adopters on Bell's theorem. If you look at who was publishing on the topic in the early years, just go to citation counts kind of measures. They had cornered the market. Certainly in North America, publishing far more articles than other groups on Bell's theorem before the topic had become really central and popular. They were deeply, deeply concerned about sort of the nature of quantum entanglement. Where conceptually does it lead? What are its ultimate implications? Is it compatible with relativity? And some of them were, you know, filing patent disclosure. They wanted to build stuff with this, right? And which I think speaks, again, to this kind of amazing moment we're in today with quantum information science, where there are devices being built, real-world tests being conducted, as well as worrying about foundational issues and theoretical matters and everything in between. And beyond that, I think through their kind of crafty, almost entrepreneurial character for many of them, they were experimenting with ways to do physics, ways to secure funding, to build institutions. These guys were getting money, in some cases, from the CIA and from private donors. The notion of kind of government philanthropy partnerships, of making institutes that are not just in a kind of older model for university departments, I think in that sense you again see at least kindred spirits in a kind of way of making spaces for quantum physics.